In August 1661, a rich banker named Nicolas Fouquet threw a big party. Fouquet held the office of Overseer of France, a position similar to today's chairman of the Federal Reserve Board. Fouquet had just completed work on a sumptuous mansion, and he wanted to show it off to King Louis XIV at his court. Fouquet had assembled a dazzling array of artists to create his chateau, Vaux-le-Vicomte, outside Paris. The chief architect was Louis Le Vaux, with gardens designed by André Le Nôtre and paintings by Charles Lebrun. To celebrate its opening, Fouquet staged a ballet by the great playwright Molière, with music by Jean-Baptiste Delully, and the evening was capped off with a fireworks display. When it was all over, Louis had Fouquet thrown in prison under charges of embezzlement, and then took over his entire team of artists. At first, Louis employed Le Vaux and Lebrun in redecorating rooms for the Louvre Palace, but Louis soon lost interest in the project and decided to remodel his father's old hunting lodge at Versailles. Louis XIV had acceded to the throne of France when he was only 5 years old. While he was in his minority, the government was run by his prime minister, the Catholic Cardinal Mazarin. During this time, there was a rebellion known as the Fronde, in which some members of the French aristocracy conspired to overthrow the young king. The Fronde was mercilessly put down, and Louis vowed to never again let the nobles of his realm have substantial power or influence. Louis's plan was to build a palace where he could bring all of the French noblemen to live with him, both so that he could watch them closely and so that he could carefully influence their opinion. Versailles was just far enough outside Paris to be isolated. In 1661, the remodeling began that would transform the old hunting lodge into the largest and most spectacular palace in Europe. The palace was under construction for over 30 years and took 36,000 workers and 6,000 horses. Over 228 people died during the construction, which spread out over 280 acres and included gardens, lakes, and fountains. At its peak, 20,000 people lived here, including 3,000 courtiers and 17,000 servants. Its cost at 65 million livres was staggering for the day. It's estimated that it took 25% of the total annual income of the French government just to keep the place running. Le Vaux's original architectural design for the palace was compact and classical, but it kept growing to keep pace with the king's ego. The painter Lebrun decorated the seven rooms of the king's apartment using the motif of Apollo, the sun god, as propaganda for Louis, who called himself the Sun King. This motif was continued in the gardens, where the pool of Apollo features the sun god in his chariot, rising from the water at the start of his day, accompanied by dolphins and tritons. André Le Nôtre's gardens kept expanding outward from the palace, until they filled the entire countryside, the way Louis intended to fill all of Europe with his radiance. The gardens were organized along a central axis that stretched for 8 miles from the center of the town of Versailles in the east to the Grand Canal in the west. When Louis realized that this axis ran through the center of the palace, he had his bedroom moved to the center of the axis to symbolize himself as the source of all power and order. Le Nôtre did all he could to show man's power over nature. Trees were felled in order to replant woods in more correct patterns. Louis had a large orange and palm orchard placed in movable containers so that during the summer months, his palace could be adorned with these tropical plants in cleverly arranged patterns. During the fall and winter, the trees were moved into a massive greenhouse. Le Nôtre crossed his main axis with numeral diagonal axes in order to create geometric compartments that were separated by trees, terraces, canals, and fountains. There were 1,400 fountains and water jets throughout the grounds, all powered by an elaborate system of pumps and plumbing that brought water from the Seine River more than a mile away. To keep up with the expanding gardens, in 1685, Louis hired a second architect, Jean-Adouin Mansart, to remodel the palace. Mansart added giant wings to the garden front of the palace and created the famous and dazzling Hall of Mirrors, filled with glass and gold and lit from the west by a large group of windows facing the afternoon sun. In Louis' rarefied universe, the favor of the king was everything. Nobles clustered around his bedside to see him get up in the morning, behold the rising of the sun, and jockey for the honor of dressing the king or holding the royal chamber pot. Everything was about manners, and conversation hovered around such topics as who wore what to the last ball, and who was in love with whom, and how embarrassing Count so-and-so was with his recent gauche remark. In such a place, life became deathly dull, and it was critical to provide the nobility with divertissement, or diversions, so that they would not try to shake off their boredom with intrigue against the king. Thus, every night the king served up, at great expense to the royal treasury, some new ballet or opera to amuse the nobles and keep them sedated. Louis XIV and his Palace of Versailles are excellent examples of the aesthetic in art that today we call Baroque. As you will read in the coming lesson, Baroque is a word that was originally coined by enemies of the style that means overdone or over the top. Louis and his palace and gardens were certainly that, and the French Revolution 100 years later clearly demonstrated that Louis's excesses were politically unwise. Nevertheless, Versailles and other Baroque works of art are dazzlingly beautiful, and when we behold them, we are grateful that mankind is willing to go to such ends for beauty's sake.